Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. In our last few segments, we've been focused on inventory, reviewing the basics and adding a few fun twists to the basic calculations of our inventory values, LIFO, FIFO, weighted average, dollar value LIFO, etc. Now, in addition to those basics, we also need to talk about some of the more advanced topics dealing with inventory. Specifically, we're talking about lower of cost or market calculations and estimations of ending inventory values. The estimations we'll talk about more later, but the idea here is that sometimes we don't have time to count all of our inventory to check and make sure that it's all there. So we have to have some calculations and some methods that auditors and others can use for a quick and dirty estimate of what we've got on hand. Lower of cost or market deals with a more painful topic. You see, sometimes companies buy inventory and then realize they can't sell it for many reasons. It could be because of some damage, because of a fire or a flood. It could be because new technology has come out and people simply aren't buying those items anymore. Or it could be that the market has simply changed and people just don't want it. There's no new technology, but people just don't care. For all of those different reasons, we have to drop the value of our inventory, and we'll talk about how to do that. This is a topic that's important to me because of an experience I had when I was a young man. You see, like many teens, I wanted my own stereo system, so I asked for one for Christmas. And I was really excited about it until I realized that it had a turntable instead of a CD player. Now, for most of you, that doesn't make any sense because you play music with your iPod or your other device, your phone or whatever. But back in the day, you listened to music on either a cassette or a CD. That's what was coming up when I was young, was CDs. But my dad had decided that CDs were not going to take off. Instead, he thought it was better to have an old record player in my stereo system because he had a lot of records that I could play using this system. Now, needless to say, he was very, very wrong. And I was stuck with a stereo that didn't play any of the new and cool music. It just played this old stuff that my parents wanted to give me. And unfortunately, in my frustration, I kept very few of their records and ended up giving away a ton of records that probably, now that they're heirlooms and antiques, are actually worth quite a bit of money, and I kind of blew it. So this was actually a big deal for me because I was dealing with technology that should have been written down and not sold, but also because I devalued these records, whereas if I'd held on to them for a few years, I could have made a lot of money selling them as sets to collectors. So I'm gonna try to do this without getting too frustrated as I have these old memories. Hopefully, we'll still be able to talk about this and still learn a lot. Let's get started. First and foremost, we care about these issues for the same reason we cared about the rest of inventory. The valuation of inventory and cost of goods sold are really the biggest parts of why most companies are in business. They make a product and they sell it, or they buy multiple products and sell them to consumers. If they can't keep track of that accurately, then nothing else really matters. So valuing inventory and cost of goods sold in any way is an important part of our business. But it's especially important in scenarios where we think that inventory has dropped in value. How are we going to deal with those? Well, that's a big issue because we want to make sure we report accurate information to our investors, but we don't make them think that the whole company is going to collapse. So there's a balance there. In addition to just the basics, well, keep in mind that if I have to write down inventory because it's obsolete, it means I did something stupid or that the market has changed, which means I've got to make sure that I know what I'm signaling to the market and understand the impact that this is going to have on my investors. So again, really important that we understand the reasons for write-downs, how we do them, and how we keep them from being a bigger issue than they have to be. The other reason that this topic or this chapter is so important is because of the fact that we're dealing with ending inventory calculations without doing that full count. And it provides us with a couple of things. Number one, it allows us to avoid the whole doing inventory process, which is long and time-consuming and expensive to pay that many employees to do the count.
It also becomes really helpful as an auditor if you can jump in and say, you know, do I need to do a full count of inventory? Let me run a quick check. You know what? I use these methods. It comes out about right. I'm not going to waste my time and energy doing a count on something that looks accurate, given these special calculations. So it can save you time in an audit, not just in a company. Also, if you're analyzing a company, same thing. Do I really believe these inventory numbers? Let me run a quick check. And then perhaps the biggest issue is when something goes wrong. If you've had a fire, if you've had a flood, if there's been a break-in, etc., tornado, whatever the natural disaster or other problem is, if you can't count your inventory because it's gone, you have to be able to report numbers to your insurance company to get reimbursed. So as nice as these methods are for avoiding some of the hassle of doing inventory or allowing an analyst or an auditor to do a quick check when they can't do inventory, it provides this really important benefit, allowing us to get an estimate of what we have lost in net bad situations. The others are really important as well, but this is perhaps the most important reason why we want a shortcut to calculate any inventory. Well, now that we've talked about why this is important, let's break down our discussion into two pieces. We'll start with writing down inventory. How do we account for obsolete items, like the record player that my dad was so good to give to me back when I was a kid? Well, normally, as we've already mentioned, we keep track of inventory at what it cost us. Historical costs. This is the same thing we do with PP&E. It's the same thing we do with intangibles. It's the same thing we do with accounts receivable. What was it worth when we first got it? But when there's a reason to believe that inventory has dropped in value, then we have to write it down. I purchased this beautiful building that was going to make me a lot of money as I rented out pieces of it. And then there was an economic slump and I can't rent out the office space. I'm using my part, but I'm losing all this revenue because nobody wants this space. Well, it's not worth as much anymore. I need to write it down. So we've done write-downs before. This is just a specific instance for inventory. Step number one in this process is perhaps the most important. Do you have a reason to believe that it has lost value? You see, this is a key piece to current GAAP. If you don't think the inventory has dropped in value, you don't have to do this test. You don't even look at it. You have to have something that makes you think inventory has dropped in value. Could be that you have a new competitor, you've produced a newer unit. It could be that, CDs are taking over from the record industry. I tell you, that was one of the most important, depressing Christmas mornings of my young life. Never mind. Let's not get into that. Let's talk about lower cost or market. My favorite story about this comes from a woman who was the chief accounting officer of a public corporation. And she had a young auditor, probably a young staff member, come in and ask her to do a lower of cost or market adjustment on her inventory just to run the test. And she looked at this young man and she said, I have no reason to believe that my inventory has dropped in value. And he thought about it for a minute and said, yeah, but my partner says that we need to run this test and just do a check. And she said, I'm sorry, but I do not believe that there's any reason to do the check. I have no reason to believe my inventory has dropped in value. Does your partner have a reason to believe this? And the staff member said, well, I don't know. He just said that we needed to run this test. And they went through this argument round and round several times. Her saying, I don't need to do this. I have no reason to believe it. And this young man saying, but my partner says you have to do it. And finally, she yells right in his face, your partner is not GAAP. I don't have to do a write-down unless you can give me a reason that my inventory may have dropped in value. And from then on, the rule was that you had to be at least a manager or higher before you could walk into her office and talk to her on an audit, because nobody at a lower level had the guts to go in for a while or was taken seriously by her after this big fight. So this was a big deal for her, and she's right. Under U.S. GAAP, if you don't have a reason to believe inventory has dropped in value, you don't have to do this test. So step number one is checking. Is there a reason to believe your inventory has dropped in value? Once you decide there is a reason and there is cause, and it's not just that your partner wants it or the PCOB says sometimes we ought to do this, I take it back. If PCOB says you have to do it, that's a different set of regulations, and you do have to follow those. So even though from a GAAP perspective you may not have to, PCAOB rules can make you do things too, as much as I hate to admit it. You know, I prefer to focus on GAAP, but it can happen. Anyway, once you decide that there's a reason for the test, then we start out by calculating what we call the net realizable value. This is what we think we can get out of this asset. And it's a really simple calculation. We take what we think we can sell it for right now, minus what it will cost us to sell that item. So for example, if I'm Walmart and I have clearance items, I go through and I look at what I marked those clearance items as being worth on my rack. So this was $100, now it's $50. Well, I think I can get it for $50. There's no additional cost, so I take $50 minus zero, and I would say my net realizable value is $50. If, on the other hand, I'm a construction company, and I've produced this, let's say we produce a set of sheds, like tough sheds that can be put in people's backyard. Then in addition to coming up with what I think people will pay for them, I also have to ship them and get them installed in order to sell them. I would take the $1,000 I think I can get from individuals minus the $200 in delivery and installation charges. So my net realizable value would be $800, the $1,000 minus the $200. Once I have a net realizable value, I compare that with the historical cost of my inventory. I'm looking at what I've got it worth on my books versus what I think I'm really going to get out of it right now. If the net realizable value is higher, then I don't worry about it. I leave it at its historical cost. If net realizable value is lower, then I have to write down to that net realizable value. And that's where the step four comes down. If the net realizable value is less than historical cost, then I do a journal entry to get my inventory from where it's at down to where I think it should be. I've got two methods that I can use to do that journal entry. I can do the direct method, where I just put it straight into cost of goods sold and take it out of inventory, or I can use what we call the allowance method, where I create an allowance to reduce inventory. That's a contra inventory account on my balance sheet, credit balance, and I record a loss as my debit, a loss due to market decline of inventory. Isn't that a great name? Now, what are the rules there? Well, you can use either method. FASB prefers the second. They want you to do the allowance. But most companies do the direct method for two reasons. First off, it's easier. If I put it into an allowance account, I have to keep track of that allowance and write it down as I sell off those inventory items. And that gets kind of hard. So I don't do it because it's harder and it's more expensive and costly to comply with this allowance method. The other reason that companies avoid it is because they don't want to show that loss on their income statement. Now, they have to disclose in their footnotes, oh, we did a lower cost or market adjustment. But a lot of investors, especially those who aren't savvy, like you will be now, that don't know what to look for, will skim over that. They'll just see cost of goods sold. They won't see a loss. They won't recognize that a lower of cost or market adjustment has happened. So if I can put it into cost of goods sold instead of creating a loss, there's a chance that some of my investors might miss it, and I won't get called on the carpet or criticized or have my stock price docked because I had some obsolete inventory. So for those two reasons, even though FASB encourages the allowance, this direct method is far more commonly used. Now, we've talked about a lot of conceptual stuff. It's time to do some journal entries and some calculations, and that's what we'll do in our next video. I'll see you then. Thanks.